morning and welcome to Grace. How's everybody doing today? Great Palm Sunday morning. We've got a Hosanna song that we'll sing with the kids coming in a little bit later, so that'll be fun. Please sing along with us if you care to. We have some words in the bulletin for you.
Ever come close, no
Today we're going to teach you a new song, Better's One Day. It's been around for a while, but this is a great song on this festive day on Palm Sunday.
On this Palm Sunday, as we gather in Jesus' name to worship Him as we continue our journey and we follow, albeit from a distance, our Lord's journey to the cross. But we're glad you're here this morning. A few brief announcements before we begin. I think as we sing their opening song, that's when we'll have the children come in waving their palms. I think that was the plan, right, Chris? Yeah, okay. Anyway, we're glad you're here this morning. We want to welcome any visitors that are with us. We're glad you chose to worship with us this morning. A few brief announcements. Wanted to fill out the welcome card right in front of you, on the pew in front of you. Fill it out, the appropriate portions, and then pass to the central aisle and we'll collect those. Also, for next week, as we count down to Easter Sunday, if you'd like to help decorate the altar in the chancel area with Easter lilies, feel free to drop them off sometime during this week. They would be greatly appreciated. Actually, if you would drop them off by 9 o'clock on Saturday morning next week, that's when the decoration will be done. You have a list of the schedule for Holy Week and Easter services in your bulletin, so we hope you'll take note of that. Also, there are sheets out, Vacation Bible School. I know there was a chill in the air this morning. But it's never too early to begin planning. We've been working on Vacation Bible School. We're starting now with a critical part of the preparation, and that is enlisting volunteers. So there's sheets for volunteers to sign up to help out with Vacation Bible School in July. So before we begin our worship, would you stand and turn and greet your neighbor and welcome them to our worship service? Anyway, if we could, I'm glad for everybody visiting, and that's awesome, because we only want you to be, if you're visiting, we only want you to be a stranger here one time. After that, you're a friend. After that, you become part of the church family. So let's, as a church family in Christ, let us worship the Lord together.
find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away.
If you would kindly remain standing and then turn to, well, today we're on page 3, the very top. We will follow the printed order of service for those who are here for the very first time, and we'll start with our invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We have raised 1,000 voices just to lift your holy name, and we will raise 1,000 more to sing for the beauty in this place. You
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon himself our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross. Mercifully grant that we may follow the example of his great humility and patience, and may be made partakers of his resurrection through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. By the way, I just want to remind you at any time during the service, when we're standing, if you, for health reasons, need to sit, feel free to do that. If you're a mom with a little one in your arms and you feel the urge to sit, that's fine as well. We don't want anybody getting faint or anything, but feel free. It's not irreverent in church to take care of your health when worshiping the Lord. But let's continue now with the reading of Holy Scripture, and then our children are going to sing for us. The first reading for Palm Sunday is Deuteronomy, the 32nd chapter. The Lord will judge his people and have compassion on his servants when he sees their strength is gone and no one is left, slave or free. He will say, now where are their gods, the rock they took refuge in, the gods who ate the fat of their sacrifices and drank the wine of their drink offerings? Let them rise up to help you. Let them give you shelter. See now that I myself am he. There is no God besides me. I put to death and I bring to life. I have wounded and I will heal. And no one can deliver out of my hand. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
As we continue with the reading of Holy Scripture, we turn now to the book of Philippians, the second chapter. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand once again for the reading of the Holy Gospel. This morning we're going to begin, we'll read two select verses from Luke, the 22nd chapter, and then we will move to read select verses from John, the 12th chapter. Now the feast of unleavened bread called the Passover was approaching, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were looking for some way to get rid of Jesus, for they were afraid of the people. John's Gospel. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus arrived at Bethany where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priest made plans to kill Lazarus as well. For on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and putting their faith in him. The next day, the great crowd that had come from the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat upon it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. Now the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had given this miraculous sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, "See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to thee, O Christ. We now join together to confess our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated for our song of the day.
slips my way, and I forget my name. Remind me who I am. In the mirror, all I see is who I don't want to be. Remind me who I am. In the lonely
Father, as we gather on this Palm Sunday, we remember our blessed Savior, his journey to Jerusalem, his journey to the cross, the agony, the suffering, the bleeding and dying. And because of what he did, we are forgiven. Because what he did, we are free. Because of what he did, we live forever. So, Father, speak to us in your word today, and we pray, God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. How many of you knew that today was the first day of spring? Okay, good. Some of you did. Now, that's according to the calendar. But according to the air temperature this morning, I think it was 28 degrees. That says winter to me. It's winter even by Wisconsin standards. Now, the sky says spring. The air temperature, your skin says winter. Now, what I find, the reason why I say that, because I find it kind of amazing. I try not to watch weather forecast on TV. I use my weather app on my phone instead. Because there are times you don't really need to turn on the weather to find out what's going on where you live. I can look out my window and see that it's sunny. I can look out my window and see that it's raining or snowing. I don't need someone to tell me it was cold this morning. I could feel it on my skin. I went back and got a coat. I don't need a weather forecast or a meteorologist standing out on their weather deck telling me that it's snowing. I can see that on my own deck, that it's snowing. I can also see storms brewing, storms moving out of the west. I can see dark clouds gathering, moving, and I can see the wind kicking up. I can see trees bending and leaves twisting in the wind, all without Doppler radar. It's not sophisticated. I've got a very sophisticated weather detector. It's called my back. And some of you know, as you get older, your back is a good indicator of what the weather is really like or what it's going to be. It's amazing, though, all the gyrations, all the stuff they make theater out of weather forecasting, none of which we need. Now, the reason why I point it out is because in John's gospel that we read a few moments ago, there's a storm brewing, not a weather related storm, but a political and religious storm. These storm fronts coming and moving in over the city of Jerusalem leading up to and during the Passover week. The final impact, the full impact of the storm was really felt on Friday. But this storm brewing over Jerusalem was a perfect storm because you have different groups, all different players, converging on the city, making both religious leaders and Jewish leaders, the religious Jewish leaders and the Roman leaders, a little bit uneasy. Because neither one of them wanted, with that mass of people converging on the city, to have any kind of civil unrest. But you have to understand that there were a number of people living in Jerusalem, but there are also pilgrims coming for the annual Passover. Every Jew the world over, that was their lifelong ambition to one day celebrate the Passover in Jerusalem. There's always been a saying among the Jews, this year here, next year in Jerusalem, always a dream. So there are pilgrims coming. It's interesting that they came up with a count of how many people had descended on the city, teeming with people from all over the known world. What they did was a census, not of people, mind you, but they did a census of the lambs that were sold, that were purchased for the Passover, because basically you were to have one lamb per household. If your household was smaller and a neighbor didn't have you to bring the guest into your home to celebrate the Passover, there was at least required 10 people at the Passover meal. So they determined by the number of lambs that were sold to serve 10 people, that there were probably a couple of million people who had come to Jerusalem. So you had the residents there, they're astir because the center of this storm is Jesus, and by extension, Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. But there's a storm gathering, there's a buzz, there's a lot of talk about Lazarus, a lot of talk about Jesus, that miracle worker. They came from as far away as Greece. In fact, in John 12, we read that Greeks came to Philip, and I think they came to Philip, by the way, because he had it sounded like a Greek name, you know. And they said, we want to see Jesus, and they brought him to these Greek visitors to Jesus. But the city is teeming with people, overflowing with people, people going as far away as out into the suburbs, if you will, of Bethany, because the city was so crowded. Now, in our country, if there's ever a major event, like a sporting event, in a given city, a large city, I can tell you, unless you prepare in advance, you're not going to get lodging the night of. That's not going to happen. That was a challenge that people had in Jerusalem, coming in for the Passover, teeming with people. And there's a lot of commotion, a lot of excitement. Now, there's also, with that crowd that size, potential for unrest, potential for trouble. The religious leaders were concerned, and so were the Romans, as they watched, especially the religious leaders. They were really watching this potential storm developing with all these groups descending there was a mixture of trouble in the making. So the religious leaders are concerned because it seems wherever Jesus goes, there's a bit of a tempest. People are talking, people are watching, people are being stirred, people are following him. And so the religious leaders, led by the Pharisees and the Sadducees, are threatened by Jesus' presence. Because he was amassing a large following, we read in the gospel that there were many Jews who had come to follow Jesus and put their faith in him. Why? Because he had raised a man from the dead. That's exciting. Let me ask you, when was the last time you ever saw a man raised from the dead? Didn't think so. You can see why there was interest. It had never happened before that they were aware of that one was raised from the dead, but Jesus had raised a man who had been dead, not one, not 2 days, but 4 days. And even any skeptic in a Jewish culture would understand by the fourth day the body is decomposing, he's dead, stone dead. But they heard that Jesus had raised him from the dead. And see, that was a problem for the Sadducees. It's interesting, we read in the gospel today that the leaders feared the people. They feared Jesus because politically he was a liability. If he stirred up some commotion, that would be a problem for them with the Roman officials. He was a blasphemer spiritually. They thought he was an imposter, but politically he was toxic. And they thought, man, if this guy gets a following, if he stirs up things, they saw him as a rebel. If he stirs up trouble, the Romans could descend on us like locusts. And we want to keep that coexistence we have with Rome. They liked what they had. They liked their way of life. But I want to get back to this idea, this notion that the religious leaders feared the people. I'm kind of curious why. You ever wonder why these religious leaders who held sway over the hearts and minds of these people, who dictated their way of life, their lifestyle, why they were afraid of the people? For one simple reason, numbers. If these people get too out, they could potentially, following Jesus, who they saw as an agitator, that it could get out of hand, and what would happen is Rome would come down on them and they would lose their position. They were afraid of too much commotion. And let's face it, just with the peaceful pilgrims that gathered this year for the Passover, as in past years, they were peaceful people. Nobody was going to do any damage, but the religious leaders were concerned. They resented Jesus. They resented the situation he possibly could pose, although he was no threat to them either, neither were the people. Yet, the Sadducees were a religious class to which every priest belonged, which is fascinating to me because the Sadducees, although they were a religious sect, are anti-supernatural. They don't even believe in the resurrection. And so what I find amazing is they're so threatened by this report that one was raised from the dead. But they were the aristocratic class. They worked in close collaboration with the Roman authorities. As long as they mind their own business, the Romans will leave them alone, let them be self-governing. They were the ruling class. They curried favor with Rome. They scratch our back, we scratch their back. Everybody was fine. But if there was any civil unrest under their watch, these religious leaders, the Roman authority would come down on them like a ton of bricks, and they would not only quell the uprising, they would remove the Jewish leaders from a position of privilege and power, something they couldn't countenance. So in their minds, in their twisted, deluded minds, Jesus posed a threat that he had to be killed. We saw in Luke's gospel, the two verses I read from Luke, they sought a way to kill him. That was a goal, and we see that his death would occur by the end of the week, but not exactly in the way they thought. They thought they were in control. But the second thing is they saw a problem with this man, Lazarus. Because people are not only coming now for the Passover, that was understood, that was an annual occurrence. What was different this Passover, that people are coming, some of them genuine pilgrims who want to know more about Jesus, but there are curiosity seekers. There are curiosity seekers who wanted to see the guy that's raised from the dead. When was the last time you heard of a dead man walking? Now, if you notice when you're driving down the interstate, all of a sudden you drive along 70 miles an hour, because you guys do drive 70, right? Right, guys? Right, Chris? Yeah. You drive 70 miles an hour, all of a sudden the traffic starts slowing, and it's gridlocked for miles. What on earth is going on? There was no construction here. Well, you find out that there was an accident northbound and you're southbound, and Everybody's got to slow up and look. The only thing slowing traffic are people that want to see a wreck. And so the way that some people today want to see a disaster, there are people who are curiosity seekers who wanted to see the dead guy. So now you've got the Passover pilgrims, you've got the curiosity seekers, you've got the religious leaders who are coming over to Jesus, you've got those who won't trust him and will not believe in him, and all this mixed together could spell disaster. And so there's a storm brewing and a little bit nervous. So what are the Pharisees, what are the Sadducees going to do? They got this dilemma. They've got a man that was raised from the dead, and because of him, many Jews believed in Jesus. What are we going to do? They had a simple plot. Simple, easy plot. They were going to destroy the evidence. In other words, what they were going to do, how are they going to destroy the evidence? Kill the dead guy. They wanted to kill Lazarus. Look, the guy died once already. Give him a break. And they were going to put him there because his testimony was too problematic. His presence was too problematic for them. They couldn't countenance this going on when they affirmed theologically there was no such thing as a resurrection from the dead. The man's standing right there. So they want to kill him as well as killing Jesus, and because this whole thing would disrupt the ebb and flow of their lives. And so they were going to do whatever they could to discredit Jesus, to silence him, kill him if necessary. And the same thing with Lazarus. Had been raised from the dead. Many people were talking. They couldn't silence the people about talking about Jesus. They couldn't silence people when they were talking about Lazarus. They needed something. So they're going to start. They're going to put Lazarus to death, and then they're going to go after Jesus to put him to death. People simply were excited. It was a threat to the religious leaders, and they'll do anything. They'll lie to bolster their position. And that said, it reminds you of politicians in this political year. They'll do or say anything to keep the positions of power and privilege and perks. And it just drives them mad when anybody poses a threat, that they'll lie to protect themselves. But with each passing day, with each passing moment, the crowds are getting bigger and louder and more excited. Never before had these religious leaders felt so powerless. Never had they felt so out of control of the situation. And everything they wanted to do was gain control, but they were never more desperate than they were right now. Jesus was a threat to their position of influence with the people and with the Roman authorities. With each passing day, the crowds are getting larger and larger all throughout the week leading up to this Palm Sunday. And as he makes his way into Jerusalem, the crowds are even getting louder and bigger, converging on the city. Now you've got pilgrims coming down from Bethany into Jerusalem. You've got people that are coming down the mountainside into Jerusalem, and Jesus is part of that. And they go out and they greet him as a king. When they begin to sing Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, you have to understand that was not exactly sweet music to the religious leaders. It was an offense to them. It was an offense to Herod, because not only was there a bounty on his head from the religious leaders, Herod wanted him dead too. But they came into Jerusalem and they heralded him as their king. And so we read today, the next day the crowds came. At first they learned that he's in Jerusalem, or that he's in Bethany. He's at this house where Lazarus lived. Notice he lived there again. He lived there before, was died, buried, went back and moved to his home with his sisters in Bethany. And Jesus there, they go out and they want to meet Jesus, of course, but they want to see Lazarus. And the crowds get bigger and bigger, and then finally they hear that Jesus is coming to Jerusalem. They go out to herald him as a king. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. By their actions, by their words, they're proclaiming Jesus as a conquering king. Now keep in mind, as the week progresses, as the week unfolds, as events unfold, he looks anything but like a conquering king. But conquer he did, not with clashing swords, not with armies, but by his death on the cross. He conquered sin and death, the powers of darkness, tore down Satan's stronghold, but he was a king nonetheless. But the fact, the very notion that there would be a king in Herod's domain was problematic for him. And so even though the Roman authorities, when they tried Jesus in this mock trial, found no guilt in him, nothing deserving of death, still they hand him over to the Jews to be crucified. Not because they found any guilt, simply because You've got the Jewish leaders here seeing unrest in the making. The Romans are seeing it from their perspective. There's a storm brewing, this unrest, civil unrest in our domain. We simply cannot tolerate it. It's better that one man die than the whole nation perish. So they gladly handed him over, washed the hands of this man, handed him over to the Jews who tried him in a makeshift court under the cover of darkness. How convenient it was. They took Jesus by stealth in the garden at night when he's praying. Try him at night under the cover of darkness, away from the adoring crowds. And then as they take him into custody and try him, condemn him to death. As they condemn him to death, the crowds come and they stir up crowds against Jesus. Now it's interesting because it didn't take long from Sunday to Friday. The cheers of Sunday give way to jeers on Friday. A lot of people suggest that the whole crowd that came to Jerusalem that day, that they were all chanting, crucify him, crucify him. I'm not convinced that. There were some. I would say, for example, the curiosity seekers, the rubberneckers, the people like that, that are given to sensationalism, they might turn on a dime against Jesus. But one of the things we read in Mark's gospel, I didn't read that today, but when they were trying Jesus, it says they bore false witness against him. They lied. To condemn him to death, to protect their own position, they lied. And it says again, and they lied. In both instances, in Mark 14, it says they lied and their testimonies did not agree. These lying witnesses were fomenting lies and inciting riot against Jesus, chanting, crucify him. In our day, we've known recently, all too tragically, how easy it is to whip up a mob, get them excited, start rioting, destroying a town or a city. In fact, we've seen it too many times recently. Because there are some people who are easily swayed, easily incited to unrest. Human nature, beloved, has never changed in thousands of years. It was just as easy back then to incite certain elements of that crowd. To chant in, crucify him, especially after they deliberately deceived the people and falsely accused him. So it looked on the surface that they had won. The Jewish leaders got what they wanted. He was dead. The Romans quelled an uprising. The storm had passed by Friday. Peace was maintained. And this brewing storm became nothing but a tempest in a teapot. What I find amazing, though, is that they acted, as Paul would say years later, that regarding himself, that they acted in ignorance and unbelief. What I find amazing, just from the Old Testament, Genesis 49, when Joseph, who was sold into slavery, met his brothers after many years, said to them, regarding, they were wept for selling him into slavery, he said, what you meant for evil, God intended for good, for the saving of many people. What these people, the Romans and the religious leaders, meant for evil, God intended for good. What they didn't realize on this day, on this week, when they crucified the Son of God, they were fulfilling the eternal plan of God. They crucified him according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. What they didn't realize is that God was in control this week. God was in control of these events. Jesus wasn't a helpless victim, as I shared on Wednesday. No, actually, he was a willing victim. He went and laid down his life at the time of his choosing. He was absolutely in control. He chose the timing, the location, every detail about his death. He was in control. What the religious leaders, what the Romans did, they thought they were playing the dutiful role of peacekeepers, and they were proud of themselves for that, for keeping down the uprising. But the role they really played was not peacekeepers. They played the role of useful idiots, used to carry out the plans of Almighty God to redeem us. And it's amazing, ironically, as these people yelled, crucify him, as they went through this trial and nailed him to the cross, from that cross, his first words were, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. Little did they realize, because of their evil intent, because of their villainy, that prayer of Jesus could be answered by his death on the cross. Father, forgive them, because they do not know what they are doing. Let us pray. Father, we thank you this day for your grace and for your mercy, for delivering up your Son according to your definite plan of foreknowledge. Lord, when we see evil abound, we know that all things work together for good. Now, Father, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. We're going to call on the ushers at this time to receive our tithes and offerings. Our Savior. Father, we thank you this day that he redeemed us from death, not with silver or gold, but with his precious blood, in order that we might be your own, live under you in your kingdom, and serve you in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, even as he has risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity. Father, we know that in our world in which we live, it is very restless world, a very tumultuous world, a world of violence, a world filled with evil, and yet in the darkness there is hope. In Christ we shall triumph, now and in eternity. Father, we know that what men intend for evil, you will work for your good, because you work all things together for your good, for your purposes, according to your plan in Christ. So Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have redeemed us, you've called us, you've sanctified us in the faith. Father, preserve us in our faith. Protect us from all harm and danger. Preserve us from the evil one. Protect us from bodily harm. Bring healing to those that are ill. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great nation. Though our nation in turmoil, there's a nation in which there's still hope because there's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the liberty we have to gather this morning to worship you. Father, thank you, too, that you've given to your people in Christ the gift of intercessory prayer. And so we pray with hearts of gratitude for answered prayer. We pray your continued blessings upon Audrey Hunt, now recovering from surgery at Eden Meadow. We pray for Steve and Debbie Loker, who are now at home recovering from hospitalization, from respiratory ailments. We pray that your hand of healing would be upon them. And for those that we bring before you that we name quietly in our hearts, that your hand of healing and grace would be upon them. Father, thank you that you hear and answer prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We continue now. The service of Holy Communion begins at the very bottom of page 7. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is good and right.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. Therefore, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might prepare joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and saying, Lord Jesus, remember us when you come into your kingdom and teach us ever to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
of trouble I wish was in there. And I have asked a thousand ways that you would take my pain away. That you would take my pain away. I'm trying to understand how to walk this weary land, make straight the paths that crooked lie. Oh Lord, before these feet of mine. Oh Lord, before these feet of mine. When upon the earth, you healed the broken, lost, and hurt. I know you hate to see me cry. One day you will set all things right. Yeah, one day you will set all things right. When my world is shaken, I
Thank you.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty and everlasting God, that you have refreshed us through this gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.